Everything changed for me the day Damilola Taylor died. That was it, that changed everything. I remember the day vividly. I came off the bus and literally, as soon as I got off the bus, you could see a blue flashing light. And then, obviously, as I got closer, it became more brighter. And they locked off this whole road. And the police officer just told me, you can't come here, a kid just died. So I got home now, and then just opened the door. And then my mum was like, supposed to shout out my Nigerian name, which I'm not gonna say. And she's just looking at the TV, and she was just crying, like just eyes watering. And then Damilola Taylor's mom started talking, and then she just started crying for no reason, like just literally crying on her knees. And I think she grabbed my little brother and hugged him, and she just said, that could have been one of you guys.
Police are hunting for the killers of a 10-year-old boy who was stabbed to death on his way home from school earlier today. Nigerian-born Damilola Taylor crawled up these steps on a housing estate in Peckham, South London, in a desperate attempt to escape his attackers. He was still wearing his school uniform when he died.
Damilola Taylor, a 10-year-old boy from the same country my parents are from, died. That could have been me. And that's what scared my mum the most. It could have been any one of us. 2 months later, my mum moved us out of London. I remember the day we moved, and like it's like one of those happy memories, because I remember my dad, he's a very silent person, so when he was kind of telling people where to go and what to do, I was just like, yeah, that's my dad. I remember sitting in the backseat, and I'm seeing the whole of Peckham just flash by right behind my eyes. So like you see the mosque, the big Peckham library, the churches. It was my London, my multicultural London. So we keep going now, keep going. And all I see is horses, I see cows. I'm like, what, where are we going? And then, you know when you're driving and you get the speed limits and the 3 bars and it goes 2, then 1. And so I'm just like looking at that. I'm just like, yeah. I see pitch black, I'm asleep. Wake up now, see this house. I'm like, that's my house. And my dad just grabbing me, just like, you better behave yourself. The first week we were there, I just stayed inside my house. I didn't really go out, I didn't want to do much. And then one day, my mom just asked me to go to the shops for her. I remember walking out of my house and walking down this long path. And all I saw was white people. Like, literally, just different shades of white. So I go to the shop, but when I enter the shop, everyone keeps looking at me, like staring at me. And then the cashier just gave me this kind of like, what are you? I'm just like, okay, cool. So next thing you know, I finish buying what I need to buy from the shop. And I walk down the road and all I hear is, oi, nigga! What?
Oi, nigga.
I look up. I see a little boy calling me a nigga. And then he looks at me, just stares at me and starts making monkey sounds. I basically got home and I just kept it to myself. Like, I could have told my mom, hey, the area you moved us to, they're kind of racist. Is there a way you can like get a return on the house that you just paid for and just, you know, send us back? And I can't go to my dad telling him someone called me a nigga because he's gonna think I'm weak. And if I cry in front of my dad, he's gonna think I'm even weaker. At that age, I was trying to look up to my dad. I was trying to be a man. I was trying to get my dad's love and my dad's affection. And I just really wanted my dad to love me. It's not like he didn't love me. He just had a very hard way of showing it. And at that age, I didn't want to show him any kind of weakness. Remember when I was young, like whenever we, got my dad angry, he would beat his chest as loud as he possibly could and say, I'm a lion. Do you know what a lion is? He's the king of the jungle. It means you can't mess with a lion. And I just got that in my system. If he's a lion, then I must be the son of a lion. And I can't show weakness. So I just went into my room, I closed the door. I just screamed as loud as I possibly could, but with nothing coming out my mouth. I soon realized that the area that we lived in was run by these two families. These people just looked... I know it sounds really weird to say, but when you... Is it possible to say that you can see bad in someone by just looking at them? The guy who was in charge at the time, I wish I could say his name, but I'm not going to. He just does this and does that. I just felt, oh crap. Like, it doesn't get better, does it? First fight I got into was with a kid at school, a white kid. But the way they fight compared to London is completely different. So in London, if you want to fight someone, you grab them, you just instant, as in instant punch. You make someone angry, boom. In Essex, they're like, meet me round the alleyway, round the back, and me and you gonna go at it. Okay, yeah, I'll do that. So basically, we organized the fight. It was on a large field. And I just see like a crowd of white people in a circle. And as soon as I enter, they kind of open the thing. It's like, is this him? Is this him?
Get away, you black cunt.
Fuck off. Why the fuck are you over here, boy?
Why are you over here?
Why are you over here? You black boy?
Get the fuck out of here.
Don't fucking stare at me.
What are you doing? White boys and black boys don't fucking mix, bro.
And next thing you know, the kid just comes up to me. And then, boom, I drop to the floor. Everything went blank. This little kid just goes boom, boom, boom on my face. And I swear to you, I didn't feel a single thing. And all I heard was, come on, mate, come on, hit him. Hit the black cunt, hit the nigger.
Hit the walk. Hit him right in the face. Hit him. Harder. Harder.
They're enjoying me get hit. I froze. So I just let him carry on hitting me, carry on hitting him until he was finished. I remember just them making the same way they parted for me to enter, the same way they parted for me to leave, but like they were following me. And they were like, oh, go on, go away then, go on, get out of our country, go on, leave us alone, see, I told you have him, I told you have him, next time the black cunt gets Larry. I was just scared, man, just scared. Remember, like, my eyes just, remember them being puffy, like too, like up to here. But I remember just going into the sink and I'm just trying to, I don't know why I thought I could wash it away. I just started crying. I never cried like that before. You know, there was those deep inhale cries. I remember hearing my mum footsteps like slowly coming up the stairs. She saw me. Her eyes were like that. And she just started speaking in her native tongue and started saying, my life, my life, my life. What have I done? Who done this to my son? She blamed my dad because she felt like if he was at home, then he would have known where I was going or he would have heard it. And he would have could have stopped it. But because he wasn't there, you know, she blamed him for that. In a way, he felt like she was right because he should have been Superman, right? Like, that's what dads are meant to be. And like, he wasn't able to do that. And I think that added to more of their problems, which added to more of my problems. He basically quit his job in London after that, and he started looking for work around the area. But it didn't really work out, and that put a strain on the family. My dad became a very angry person. But it's cool. After I lost that fight, I just said to myself, the only way I'm gonna survive is if I fit in, if I become like them. So I did whatever I needed to do to fit in to a group of people who hated the color of my skin. I started with my clothing. I would literally save all my dinner money up, starve myself, literally I turned into a little twig. just so I can buy all the latest clothing, like Lila Scott, Mackenzie hoodie, tracksuits, and anything I would see all the big top guys wear. That's what I wanted to wear. And then next, you know, it went to the hair. You know, at the time they had the spiky hair was the thing back in the day. So I literally would buy this thing called, it's a texturizing cream that would straighten your hair. And then I just got the accent. I'm just like, start putting a bit of swing on it. I'm like, you're right, mate. And they're like, what is that going? Yeah, mate, it's me. How you doing? You all right? You want to go for a pint? Yeah. So I was just talking like them. I was like, yeah, I want to be like you. After that, I remember thinking to myself, the perfect white man has blue eyes. So I said, F it, I want blue eyes too. So I went to the local shop and I bought the brightest blue contact lens that I could find. And the final thing I did was I bleached my skin. I remember the first time I did it, and I remember putting a load on my hand, like going like that, looking at the skin, like mirror, I'm like, yeah, am I light? And I'm not light, so I just put some more. Next thing, I wake up in the morning and my skin's just like a tad bit lighter. I'm like, wow, I had enough. I wanted to be, it's not even like I wanted to be white. I just wanted to fit in. And if it meant being like white people, then let's do it.
We're doing coming over these ends, bro.
Over time, I started to become friends with, I guess, the racists or the families, and I guess all the people that didn't like black people in the area. I became friends with them. I wasn't a threat anymore. I was just a black kid who wanted to be like them.
How old are you?
16. To fit in, I felt like I had to keep silent. I had to not talk on some things I thought were important things, and certain situations and certain predicaments, I would just find a way to side the white people. We had a situation one time whereby we were walking down, we were about to go to a little party with my mates.
Relax!
Hey, hey! What are you saying here?
And the white and black guys got into a little, you know, altercation.
You fucking run away, you fucking run away.
And he said something, he was like, oh, he's a fucking nigger.
He's a fucking black cunt.
It's like, not you, Cornelius, I'm not talking about you.
I'm talking about your friend.
And in that moment, I just like, I'm not proud of it. I just said, yeah, cool. Like, I get it. But these are my friends. What am I meant to say?
What did you say?
I didn't say anything. There wasn't anything for me to say. We started smashing houses. We started smashing cars. It got very violent. Enjoyed it. It let me get rid of all the pain, all the anger I was feeling for my dad. So I liked it. Do you want to know, like, the weirdest thing? The only thing I wish as a like 10-year-old kid back then was just wanting my dad to love me, you know? But I feel like he was hurt a lot. And so he hurt us a lot. So I hurt a lot. I just kind of like feel like why, you know? Like why would you do that? You know, like why? And it just pisses me off because I just don't feel like you should treat people like that. Really bothers me because it's just like it really messed me up. We went out on a rampage one night and there was this guy with a bike.
Oi!
And I don't know what came over me, but I just punched him for no reason. He didn't say anything, just punched him. And then he dropped. And then I remember seeing him on the floor and then I just kicked his head. But when I kicked his head, he screamed from the top of his lungs. And I just remember seeing his face and he just caved in. He was like, I feel guilty. I feel guilty. But I felt like I was accepted.
Right, you show it like that, where you bother it. Like, you don't want to butt it off because then it's bare wet and you get up and spit your mouth. It's horrible.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's it, bro.
You're talking about a black kid being accepted by racists. And they were cool with me, like me of all people. And it felt good. Felt good. Just made friends and monsters.